Dear students, welcome to the session on time value of money. After listening to this lecture video, you will understand about why time value of money, or why people call it as time preference for money, and its importance, and the computation of future value and present value of cash flows. It may be future value of a single flow or an annuity. Similarly, present value of a single flow or an annuity. Before getting into the methods involved in computing the future value and the present value, let us now understand why time value of money. Generally, individuals prefer possession of a given amount of cash now rather than the same at future time. The main reason for the time preference or the time value of money is that the availability of investment opportunities. There can be other reasons, the reasons of uncertainty of cash flows in future and preference for present consumption of goods, commodities and services. Generally, people used to say a rupee in hand today is more valuable than a year hence. It is because of these three reasons. You know, it is the preference for current consumption rather than the future consumption. The consumption, not necessarily be consuming of goods and services, but the investment opportunities also may make them to think that holding cash now today is more valuable. Secondly, productivity of capital. If people hold cash in hand today, it can be invested in some productive investment avenues. Capital can be employed productively to generate positive returns. An investment of rupee 1 today would grow to 1 plus R a year hence. R is the rate of return earned on the investment. So, maybe because of this reason, people say a rupee in hand is more valuable than a rupee a year hence. That is, a rupee that you may likely to receive in future. So, the time preference can be expressed in terms of interest rate. The time preference rate of money, it can be called as time preference rate of money. It is the interest rate. So the interest rate can be expressed as time preference rate of money. Interest rate gives money its value and it facilitates the comparison of cash flows occurring at different time periods. So the minimum interest rate in the absence of any risk is known as risk-free rate. It is a compensation for time or even compensation for the waiting period or the sacrifice that you do today to get a positive return. So if an individual is exposed to some degree of risk, he would expect a rate of return higher than the risk-free rate from the investment, compensating him for both time and risk. So the rate added to compensate risk is known as risk premium. The interest rate permits the individual to convert different amounts offered at different time to certain amount that is equivalent to its today's value, or he always tries to convert it to a common point of reference for making decisions. Similarly, a rupee today is considered to be more valuable than a rupee later under circumstances where the economic condition is in inflationary position. So people would prefer to protect their buying power, purchasing power. For that sake also, people may think that what they have in their hand may be. So inflationary economic condition may also be one of the reasons why people think a rupee in hand today is more valuable than a year hence. Time value of money is considered to be one of the important factors for making financial decisions. How that the time value can be adjusted? What is its importance? Let us now have a look at it. Most financial decisions, such as purchase of assets or procurement of funds, affect the firm's cash flows in different time periods. So, cash flows occurring in different time periods are not comparable because of the inflationary economic condition and because of the expectations of the interest rate by the supplier of money. Hence, it is required to adjust the cash flows for the differences in timing and risk. So, the value of cash flows to a common time point should be calculated. To achieve the objective of wealth maximization of investors, the time and the quality of cash flows, the time value and the quality of cash flows, quality in terms of risk, are considered to be important indications. So, while making financial decisions with the objective of maximizing shareholders' wealth, the timing and the risk aspects are to be kept. So, the choice of the risk-adjusted discounted rate, that is the interest rate, taking into account the time preference, is important for calculating the present value of cash flows or the stream of cash flows that are likely to occur in future. It can be converted into today's value by adjusting the risk factor involved in it. So, in such case, such an interest rate is called risk-adjusted interest rate. For example, if time preference rate is 10%, let us assume, it implies that an investor can accept receiving rupees 100 if he is offered rupees 110 after 1 year. So, rupees 110 is the future value of rupees 100 today at 10% interest rate. Therefore, the individual is indifferent between 100 and rupees 110 a year from now, as he considers these two amounts equivalent in value. You can also say that rupees 100 today is the present value of rupees 110 after a year at 10% interest rate. Now let us understand the importance of adjustment of time for making short-range or long-range financial and its implications. Time adjustment is considered to be important for both short-term and long-term financial decisions. If the amounts involved are very large, time value adjustment, even for shorter period, will have significant implications. However, other things being same, adjustment of time is relatively more important for financial decisions with long-range implications than with short-range implications. Present value of amounts far in the future will be less than the present value of amounts in the near future. So, what you must try to understand is that most financial problems involve cash flows occurring at different points of time. These cash flows have to be brought to the same point of time for the purposes of comparison, analysis, and decision making. So, you should be able to understand the tools for converting cash flows occurring at different points in time. Cash flows in terms of receipts and payments that are to occur at different points in time. So, the compounding and the discounting are the two important tools that are used to convert cash flows to a common point in time. Therefore, you should understand the tools of compounding and discounting, which influence most of the financial decisions, most of our activities, what we do in finance, especially on valuing securities, analyzing projects, determining lease rentals, choosing right financing instruments, setting up of loan amortization schedule, valuation of companies, and so on and so forth. When cash flows occur at a different point in time, it is easier to deal with them using a timeline. Okay, cash flows like receipts may likely to occur after 3 years or after 5 years, or it may likely to occur on annual basis, year-on-year basis, or on semi-annual basis, twice in a year, maybe a receipt or maybe a payment. All these are cash flows. It may be in the form of receipt or payment. So for better understanding, we should know about the timeline. A timeline shows the timing and the amount of each cash flow in a cash flow stream. Therefore, a cash flow stream of ₹10,000, for example, at the end of each year for next 5 years, can be depicted on a timeline or can be plotted on a timeline. So in a timeline like this, zero refers to the present time. A cash flow that occurs at time zero is already in present value terms and hence does not require any adjustment for time value of money. You must distinguish between a period of time and a point of time. Period 1, which is the first year, is the position of timeline between point 0 and point 1. The cash flow occurring at point 1 is the cash flow that occurs at the end of period 1. And the discount rate, say for example, let us assume 12%, is specified for each period on the timeline and it may differ from period to period. If the cash flows occur at the beginning rather than at the end of the end of each year, the timeline would appear like this. A cash flow occurring at the end of year 1 is equivalent to a cash flow occurring at the beginning of year 2. So cash flows can be positive or negative. A positive cash flow is called cash inflow, and a negative cash inflow is called a cash outflow. Now let us look at the calculation of future value of a single amount. Suppose you invest ₹1,000 for 3 years in a savings account that pays 10% interest per year. And if you allow your interest income to be reinvested, your investment will grow as follows. In the first year, your principal at the beginning will be ₹1,000. Interest for the year calculated at 10% on ₹1,000 will be ₹100. So the principal at the end will be ₹1,100. Second year, the principal at the beginning will be ₹1,100 and interest for the year at 10% on 1,100 will be ₹110. So the principal at the end will be 1,210. Third year, the principal at the beginning will be 1,210. Interest for the year at the rate of 10% on 1,210 will be 121. So the principal at the end will be 1,331. So the process of investing money as well as reinvesting the interest earned thereon is called compounding. The future value or compounded value of an investment after n years, when the interest rate is r, that is r percent, is future value of n number of years is equal to percent value multiplied by 1 plus r to the power n. In this equation, 1 plus r to the power n is called the future value interest factor, or simply the future value factor. To solve future value problems, you have to find the future value factors. So you can do it in different ways. In the example given above, you can multiply 1.10, that is 1 plus r, that is 1 rupee, growing at an interest rate of 10%, so 1.10 by itself 3 times. Or more generally, 1 plus r by itself n times. So this becomes tedious when the period of investment is long. Supposing this for 10 years, just imagine the type of difficulty that you may have to face when you have to do it 1.1 for 10 times. So there are some easy methods by which you can find out the future value factor. So you can use calculators. They have inbuilt functions. You would have noticed the key y to the power x in the calculator, which can be used to obtain the future value factor. Suppose you want to find the factor for 1.10, that is 1 rupee plus interest rate of 10%, 1.1. You can just enter it as 1.1 and enter the key y to the power x and enter 3. And immediately you will obtain the factor value. Or otherwise, you can consult the factor value table. Future value interest factor table can be referred to identify, to obtain the factor value. Suppose, let us consider now an example. Suppose you deposit rupees 1000 today in a bank, which pays 10% interest compounded annually. How much the deposit will grow after 6 years, 8 years and 12 years? So to find out the... So by substituting value, the factor value of 2.144, is the factor value is 2.144 multiplied by the amount of investment of rupees 1000, it will be rupees 2144 after 8 years. If it is for 10 years, future value for 10 years, for the amount of deposit of rupees 1000 growing at 10% for 10 years, again we can refer to the factor value for 10 years at 10%, 2.594. So substituting value, 2.594 times of this 1000 will be rupees 2594 will be the maturity value of the amount of deposit of rupees 1000 made today 10 years hence. Here it is 8 years hence and it is 6 years hence. Or you can use calculator also to find out the factor value. Either you can refer to the table, future value interest factor table, or you can use calculator to find out the factor value. So this is how you have to calculate the future value for single amount of cash flow or single amount of cash outflow.
Thank you.